Hello everyone, I wanted to do a recording to talk about the new class for Inquisitor Martyr. I will not have a level 99 run build ready for the world to see before the holiday break. I decided the next best thing I could do is just kind of show you the class, go over the basics, and then talk about potential builds. To save time on the recording, I am not going to go over everything. I'm going to go over what I think is best, or at the very least, worth my attention. Because if I did everything piece by piece, it's just going to turn into way too long of a recording, and I don't want to do that to y'all. I'll let you explore whatever you think you want to, and go from there. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started with the Faith resource, and all the things associated with Faith. The Faith resource allows you to turn into Embodied Saint, which gives you different skills to work with, and of course does a ton of damage. You have a passive tree, sort of related to it, and the Embodied Saint tree, as well as your Actus Faith, and that's your Saint Potentia Blessings tree. You'll notice on the left-hand side, it says the cooldown of Acts of Faith is reduced, which is great, and we'll get into why that's great, but the right-hand side is to do with Sacred Rite effectiveness, and we'll go over that as well in just a second. I just wanted to point that out, that these two are here. Eventually, you go down the tree, running into Divine Light. When you enter your embodied saint form, your first three skills are free. So, yeah, keep that in mind, because that's pretty important, too. Okay. So, in order to access all of your faith stuff, you have this faith altar. Right here on the bridge. You click on that, and this is where you mess with everything. The right-hand side is your embodied saint form, so this is where all of your skills you want to use with it are. And then on your left-hand side is your acts of faith. Your acts of faith is what you can use when you're just in your mortal form. So, at the bottom, this is your sacred rites. This is the thing that was referring to in the passive tree. This is how you gain your faith. And we'll go over that in a moment, but let's first talk about all of this other stuff. Okay, so in your bodied saint form, you can change out the skills as you want to just by simply dragging and dropping here. So I've decided to leave my charge, which is righteous judgment, as the right click, so I can kind of remember that. And then I have my AoEs on 1 and 2. So Catechism of Fire and Spheres of Radiance. These are the skills I've chosen because these are the ones that I've worked with a lot and feel are the best. There are others, however, as you can see. You have Sacred Immolation, Onslaught, so on and so forth. But I just never saw really any value in them, so if you see value in them, by all means use them. But that's the Embodied Saint form. Let's talk about this Acts of Faith stuff. So under Acts of Faith, I would say the most important one is this, which is Divine Grace. You gain a shield equivalent to 1.5 times your HP. When it explodes, it does the shield damage to all enemies around you. So it is an extremely powerful Act of Faith because of the fact that it's survivability as well as offense. I honestly have been using this way too much. But there are certainly others worth considering, and I'll show you them real quickly. Stoic Endurance would probably work best if you were doing a Reflect build, because it's 10% Reflect with 100% Reflect damage. So you get also 10% All Resist to go with that, which is cool. And then if you're the Exposed State, you get a heal, essentially. So Stoic Endurance is pretty cool. But I don't know if it's going to be any better than some of the other stuff. And we'll go over all this in just a minute, because I just want to get through this whole Faith Altar first. But I am questioning this one, Ardent Onslaught, because it takes 1,000 HP to activate. And you gain enrage tokens equal to all enemies within 5 meters. So you have to expend 1,000 HP and be pretty close to the enemy. That's a little bit scary to think about. This one I'm not sure on either. This one is Expurgation Sweep. It brings 10 enemies within 9 meters to melee range. I guess it could work, but again, we'll go over this in a moment. The other one I'm questioning is this one, Wrath of the Penitent. For every missing HP you gain, that's the bleed one, yeah. You apply bleed and vulnerabilities, that's right. Took me a minute to realize that mistake. But yeah, so I'm not sure about that one either. So there's your embodied saint form, and then your acts of faith. Now let's talk about the sacred rites, the thing you're seeing in the passive tree. So this is how you gain your faith. You start off with this, which says that you gain continuous faith regeneration per second for each enemy killed, but then it resets once you do your embodied saint form. That's the one you start with. Now there are other ones you can take, such as this one, Scalding Zeal. 8% or 0.08% faith per every dot tick. I don't think that one's great, but maybe it could work at the higher levels during Void Crusades. I don't know. I haven't really tested it yet. Then there's this one. When you activate an act of faith, gain 1% faith for each enemy within 5 meters. So I don't think that one's good because it requires you to be pretty close and requires a considerable amount of enemies to be around. You gain 3.5 faith, or 3 to 5% faith for every killing blow on champions or stronger enemies. Also gain 1% faith for every regular kill for 10 seconds after using an act of faith. So this requires you to constantly use your acts of faith. They do have a long cooldown, because I think you saw it, even with all my cooldown, my shield was at 21 seconds. So I don't think that's great. And this is Spirit of the Martyr, which is faith regeneration per second for every missing HP, so I don't think that's probably a good one either. Then there's this one, Burning Devotion. You gain a fiery aura with a 3-meter radius that deals 25% weapon damage per second for every 0.25 seconds tick. You deal... whenever an enemy's hit by, you gain 0.25% faith, so I don't think that one's really great either. I think ultimately the best one over here is this one, Spirit of the Exemplar. You gain 0.35% faith for each kill. This amount is increased by 100% per kill streak level. So I ultimately think that this is the best one out of how to gain faith and get to your embodied saint form. But I figured I would show you all that real quickly. So now we go into the second and last portion of the whole faith discussion, why I was saying what I was saying. So let me go here. Okay, like any class, you get 3 armor pieces unique to you. One of them is this, Celestian Armor. You'll notice that the armor icon has kind of like a, I guess it's silver circle-looking symbol to it. That means you can slot an Act of Faith here. There are other ways to slot more Act of Faiths, but I think ultimately the max limit is 2. I've tried testing going for 3, and it just won't let me do it. It just shuts off my slots every time I try to go above 2. But either way, so you can do this, and then you have the Holy Censor, which is your belt, and it does the exact same thing as Celestian Armor. So you can run a maximum of 2 Acts of Faith at any time, which is why I was questioning some of the other Acts of Faith, because your max is 2, so you really do have to think about what you want and what you want to do. So, keep that in mind when you're slotting your Acts of Faith and ultimately how you get to your embodied saint form. Now, let's talk about the other armors and unique weapons. Let me go to the forge for that. Oh, yeah, and you also get these banners, which are, by the way, absolutely worthless. But either way, you do get banners as well on top of the Holy Censor. So let's see. Your armor is going to be Celestian, as you just saw. Your other armor type is this one, Dominion Armor. So this one has a combat dash on a cooldown. So this does not take any special event or sequence to get its charges back. It's just on a cooldown. And on top of that, the armor itself gives you up to 8% movement speed. So this is actually a really cool armor piece. But the problem is that you can't slot an Act of Faith in this like the Celestian Armor. Your other option is the Seraphim Armor, once I find it. There it is. Seraphim armor is the complete opposite. You'll notice that it says that in order for this skill to recharge, it has to be done by killstreaks. So this one does not recharge as quickly as the other one. And even then, its damage is kind of low. So I don't really think that this is worth it on the skill itself, but what is worth it is this over here. This is the heaviest armor available to the class. You'll notice that it can get up to 28% damage reduction with 12% all resist at its maximum roll. And then, of course, 434 HP at its maximum, which is a much bigger difference than the Dominion armor, which you'll notice is 390, and it doesn't have the all resist plus. Its max roll is 23 instead of 28. So there are definitely some differences there. Okay, let's talk about your melee weapons. You do get a Blessed Blade as one of the melee weapons, and it's combined with either a Holy Rod, a pistol, or a brassiere, but I don't think that they're really worth it. So I'm going to focus on the Power Halberd and Power Maul, because these are really interesting. So here's the Power Halberd. Its auto attack is a cone, and it's armor piercing with high suppression. So that's its auto attack. It does have a triple strike ability that's also a charge. And it is armor piercing, flesh bane, stun, castigation, and cone effect. Yeah, so this charge is really powerful. And then you get this hook pull as your number one, which pulls enemies into range and also causes a bleed. And then, finally, you get this as your number two, which is basically an AoE spin. So the Power Halberd is actually really good for what it is. It's a super versatile melee weapon. Then, on the other hand, the Power Maul, not so much. You'll notice its auto attack is armor breaking, stun, and single target. So it does not hit as many targets as the Halberd, although it does have a higher damage. You do have White Strike, so basically a cone as your right mouse. So instead of a charge, you get a cone, is essentially the difference between the two weapons. Your one is a jump, essentially. It's kind of odd how it behaves, but either way. And then you have this Whirlwind Smash, which is basically it throws your target into another person or another target, so I'm not really sure on that, but you will notice that there is a damage difference between these two, because look, the Power Halberd's strike is 464 and 580. Power Halberd is 319, 399, so it does not come close to doing the damage that the Maul does on single targets. But to be fair, the Halberd is a swing by default. So there you have it. There's all that. Let's go ahead and talk about stats now. Okay, so the class gets access to Contempt, which is its damage thing. You'll notice that it does actually get 3% crit strike, or I'm sorry, crit chance pretty early on. So you can actually get this milestone just by doing your heroic deeds, which you can see I've done. Then you have Resolve, which is HP and Suppression. But one major thing is here. At Milestones 3 and 4, you start to see Embodied Saint bonuses. You get a 15% shield drain, and you gain a shield upon leaving Embodied Saint. So essentially a free shield just for existing as Saint. And then the next one is 10% of all damage that you deal in by same form is returned as health. That's extremely powerful. And then Passion, your last one, has to do with your maximum faith value and your suppression damage resistance. You'll notice that it has quite a bit of mix here. It has inoculator stuff as well as movement speed, and then your sacred rite effectiveness. So remember, that's the one that dictates your faith generation. So there you have it. There's all of that. Let's talk about the perks unique to this. So you have a couple of ones related to your banners and faith. I don't think banners are worth it, so we're not going to go over that, but we'll go over faith. So you have Saintly Resolve, which is the one that reduces the cost of faith, and you gain 1% of your max suppression back per hit in embodied saint form. So it's not that great, I don't think, but it is worth noting, I guess. You get a lot of generic stuff in here, just like every other class, but I'm trying to find where the other ones are. Oh, here's one. Oh, yeah, that's banners. Never mind. Oh, here it is. Faith and Fury. Yeah, here's another interesting one. You gain extra faith from all sources, and you gain bonus damage for every percent of current available faith. So you actually can do a build where you ignore your embodied saint form and just do this instead. But I don't think that's really worth it. But we'll see. I have to test that. You get this one, Defiance, which is 3% chance for damage to be ignored, so it's a super low percent, not really worth it. This one, however, if you're running two Acts of Faith, I could see this as being good. Because you're gaining 10% faith for each cast, so that's 20% if you do two casts, and then you gain 60% damage bonus for 8 seconds for doing it. So that's actually pretty awesome. And let's see. You gain faith on mission. I'm trying to find where is. Oh, banner stuff. Oh, here it is. Redeemer Spirit. Yeah, this is pretty nutty. 50% vulnerability efficiency, 20% supreme damage reduction, and 20% all resistances in embodied saint form. So if you're going full embodied saint form, you can definitely dish out the damage. Although I don't think that's one's worth it. We'll see. Banner, and where is the other ones? Oh, and then last but not least, you gain different stuff pending the morality choice. So if you go Puritan, you get percent of your max HP as regenerating energy shield. You gain shield regeneration and then heat damage bonus while you have an active energy shield. So keep that in mind, because as we go into builds, you'll see why I talk about that. And then the opposite is this one. If you go Radical, you gain Berserker tokens if you lose 5% of your HP in a single hit. And you also reduce the Faith Decay while Embodied Saint form by 10%. So actually, this one's really, really good. I could see this working in a build. Now, even though this is a generic talent or whatever you want to call it, I think that this is worth noting, Subdermal Plating. Because remember, Stoic Defense said reflect and reflect damage, so you can definitely stack this with Stoic Defense. So keep that in mind. Okay, now that we've kind of gone over all of this, I forgot to do the passive starts. So, let's see. I made notes of this. I think I completed one or two of my hero deeds before checking this. But anyway, Seraphim background is 4-2-1. So, 4 Contempt, 2 Resolve, 1 Passion. Celestian is 4-3-5. And then Dominion is 7-3-2. So out of this list, I actually think that Celestian is the overall best. Because no matter what you do, it always comes back to HP. Because of your shield and other things. So I think Celestian is the best background start. But either way, there you go. There's the stats. Start pages. Now I can start talking about other generic things. So let me see. We need to talk about... Oh yeah, we can do that while I'm here. So let's do the forge. Okay, so I know a lot of builds have done builds using orange and red items, but I'm beginning to question that. I don't think that you necessarily need oranges and reds to run the level 99s, and that's something I will test. However, I just kind of want to point out why I think this. see. I need the Eviscerator. So, here's a purple Eviscerator. I do have an orange Eviscerator schematic, and I just want to show you the differences. So you'll notice that the tooltip is 128 to 156. But the real important thing here is the damage skill. So to make this simple, let's just focus on Eviscerate, which is your auto attack. So Eviscerate does 199, 798. And here's a orange one. You can see the Eviscerate did not change. This did, however, the 132 to 159, but it was only by 4 points. The only thing that you really gain from doing oranges and reds, as far as I can tell from my own tests and from looking through build guides, is, of course, the relic affixes or suffixes. I'm not sure if it counts as affix or suffix, but you do have those relic affixes, like the one that says if you're below 30%, you get like ethereal or something like that. I've seen it in builds before. But yeah, so you don't really gain a lot for what you spend into the resources, because obviously jumping to orange requires the God Spark thing, whereas the purple only requires this, the more common purple. Oh, and also this changes too, because look, it's 60, 80, 100. This is 15, 30, 15. Yeah, so you expend a lot less materials on purples than you do oranges. So I wanted to point that out real quickly, because as we go into builds, you'll see why I'm thinking that it's not worth it going oranges. But I have to talk about critical strikes next. So let me, and Psalms. Let me go and tab over though. Let's start with criticals. So I found this chart, and I can't really find any confirmation as to if this is accurate or not, but if it is accurate, this is a pretty big deal, because it tells me that you would have to have a lot of critical strength to even see more than 150%. Because of that, I'm beginning to think that's not worth it either. I think that you can just let your passives give you a critical strike strength, and then let your items roll something else. That's essentially my logic here, because your passives, at least under the critical strike tree, or even the physical, will give you critical strike strength, which is all you need to trigger this 150, apparently. So if this holds true, then that means you just do the passives for critical strength, and then you let the items roll critical strike chance, and then you roll whatever the build needs after that. Okay. Now we have to talk about Psalms. This is kind of the other general information. So there are combinations with Psalms that you can do in items to give you different benefits. So let's go ahead and first point out that only certain items have certain numbers of slots for these combinations. The two-handed and armor are the biggest ones at 6 maximum possible sockets. And then after that is only 3s on the other pieces. This is another reason why I was saying one hand is not worth it. But anyways, I would take note of, where is it? A corpus, yeah. Corpus is HP regeneration. Okay, but anyways, let's go down to the Psalm code combinations. So you'll notice that if you scroll all the way down to the... let's see, where is it? The big ones, yeah. Yeah, if you scroll all the way down here, you'll notice things like this right here, which takes, what is that, 5? 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, 5. That takes 5 for that combination, but you'll notice you get 50% heat damage and heat resistance of enemies is halved. So I think that actually, no matter which build you plan on doing, you probably want to take this in your torso piece because of the fact that the embodied Saint Form runs purely on heat. So this is more embodied Saint Form damage, and also it's lowering the resistances. So you have a little bit better damage with it. There is a physical one, and it's right here. Right below it, it's also 5. We'll come back to all of that, though. I just wanted to point out these are the Psalm combinations, and also why I'm thinking purples are worth it, because of purples not only having a cheaper cost, but also it makes it a little bit easier to kind of reroll so that you can ensure you have the sockets for these Psalm combinations. But we'll come back to that with the builds. Okay, let me go back into the game. Okay, so another reason that I was saying for doing purples is because of the reduced costs was because then that way you can ensure you can run two items. Or I'm sorry, two items, or I should have said two weapons. Because, let me show this. I think that there's two potential builds, Heat and Muley. Base build, because obviously your embodied Saint Form runs on it, but let me show you this real quickly. So you'll notice with my current passives that the auto attack for the Melta Gun generates 0.8 heat, does 390 and 892. If I tab over to the Flamer, it's 241. And 0.55 heat. So you do generate a little bit more heat with the Melta Gun, but you're ensuring that each shot is a higher damage. And not only that, the Melta Gun is armor piercing. So if you do run into a heavily armored enemy, you'll find yourself using less heat on the armored enemies than the Flamer. So this is another thing where I think build kind of went wrong way back in the day with this game, is because they relied on one weapon, but the problem is each weapon has its own benefit against certain enemies. And so you'll see that even with the Power Halberd and Power Maul. But I just want to point this out, that you're dealing with two completely different sets of keywordings combined when you run two weapons. So that's why I was saying purples are worth it, in my opinion, because if you think about it, it's not just lowering the cost, but it's also ensuring build diversity, so that you can swap between weapons as you run to different threats. But anyways, moving on. So I want to talk about the commonalities of both the Heat and Melee builds that I think can work. I think that you should run your Potentia Blessings thing as this, because if you do manage to get into your Embodied Saint Form, you get 3 free casts here. And then, this is really only one more point after it, and that's lowering the Axe of Faith by 1 second. That's, in my opinion, way more worth it than cooldown reduction, but it is good to have a combination of both. Either way, though, I think this is how the build should run their Potentia Blessings page. And then, the other commonality, I think, between the builds that should happen is this right here. You'll notice this whole line's cooldown reduction, except for this, but all these are cooldowns. So, oh, and then of course your critical hits. So you'll notice I ran it like this because I am switching between Mortal Form and Embodied Saint Form, and I'm pretty sure Embodied Saint Form is ranged, not melee. So there's that. Before we move into the build specifically, let's go ahead and talk about this whole mess right here, No Remorse, and of course, Berserker Rage. Almost every build that I've seen on YouTube runs these two, and I don't think it's worth it. Because if you notice, it says 1% of your max HP healed on a critical hit. I've looked at so many different builds on YouTube, and I found one by a channel, I think the name was Cheezus. I'll link it in the description, but I think it was Cheezus. And he had a Flamer Crusader build and a couple other Crusader builds. And I noticed on one of the Crusader builds, I can't remember if it was the Flamer one or not, but it was floating right around 7,500 HP. So that means at 7,500 HP, this is only healing you for 75 health when you're critical. Considering that you have to take a 5% damage reduction for that, I just don't think it's numerically of value, because yeah, you get 75 health back, but you're also taking 5% more damage, so you're not really gaining anything at that point. So I would say just screw it, ignore this whole thing over here. I would take 1 point into critical hit strength, because like I pointed out with the website, you can definitely make it so that you can rely on passives to get your 150% crit damage, and then just rely on the SOM codes for your damage. Now, let's go and talk about specific builds, starting with the heat build. So I'm not sure if the heat build's really going to work, because what I've seen with the Crusader builds and also the Assassin builds is that they're using either a passive or a talent to remove their cooldown by swapping weapons. So when you swap weapons, you immediately eliminate the cooldown. Or, I'm sorry, the overheat. So, unfortunately, the Battle Sister does not have that luxury. You do have this, which is 50% overheat cooldown speed. And then over here under Warfare, you do have these, which is overheat capacity. There is only three of them, though. So, one, two, three. So you could do that, I guess, to kind of reduce how often you overheat. But even then, like I said, I'm not really sure if it's going to work, because you don't have the ability to swap and eliminate the overheat. But if you were to do it, I would say run a Melta Gun and Flamer, and then just run all but this skill over here. You don't want to lower your critical hit chance by 5%. You don't. Just run the whole tree besides this over here, if you're going to do the heat build. And then, of course, just run all the critical strike chances for ranged combat, and you should be fine after that. If you want to run the health thing, that's entirely up to you. I think that there's some things you can do with the purple armor to get regen, which should help you. But that's entirely optional for this build. And as far as defense is concerned, I think that's probably optional too, considering that you're not really going to be running deflect. I mean, I guess if you wanted to put some points in here for, like, the damage reduction, you could totally do that. But that's entirely up to you. Okay, let's talk about the melee build. Okay, so for the melee build, I think for that one, I would run the Power Halberd and Power Maul, because what you want to do is use the Halberd for clearing out waves of enemies, or two enemies right next to each other, and then Power Halberd if you manage to get one enemy alone, smack that face in. I think that that would be the best way to handle it. I could see the melee build running two potential pathings. One is a critical strike build, and the other is running reflect. Because as I pointed out with subdermal plating, you do have the option for reflect, and then of course you can further that with stoic endurance. So you could definitely run a reflect build if you want to, or you could run critical with a melee. But either way, I think it's going to be Power Halberd and the Power Maul, because then you just switch between the two as the situations change. As far as the armor is concerned on both builds, though, that's where I'm going to leave that decision to you. I think for the melee builds, probably Dominion armor, because you do need to close the distance as much as possible. However, if you want to run the deflect build, you'll probably will need Celestial armor, so you can run your shield plus Stoic Defense. If you're running the ranged build, I would say probably Dominion armor for sure, because you want to be able to move around as quickly as possible, so you can run and gun. But again, I am leaving that all up to you. Those are just some ideas. That's really all I have on this particular class. Thanks for listening.